Next, seeking peace in Syria and around the globe. Jeffrey Brown talks to former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan.
Kofi Annan, the first career UN staffer to rise to head the organization, has spent more than 40 years dealing with one international crisis or another and the problems of bringing the international community together to deal with them. He tells that story in a new book, Interventions, A Life in War and Peace, from the young man in newly independent Ghana to a Nobel Peace Prize-winning Secretary General of the United Nations, to most recently his role as a special envoy to Syria, with the mission, one that failed, of finding an end to that still unfolding drama. As he makes clear in his book, and when we spoke yesterday at the Council on Foreign Relations in New York, the organization and the world continued to be haunted by the tragic failures of the 1990s. The collapse of a peacekeeping mission in Somalia and the starvation and killings amid civil war, the genocide of at least 800,000 people in Rwanda that occurred, as Annan writes, under the gaze of a UN peacekeeping operation, and ethnic cleansing in Bosnia, including the massacre at Srebrenica, a UN-designated safe area.
In all these cases, part of the reasons for failure perhaps was not analyzing and assessing the true nature of the crisis, the resources that will be required, and exaggerated expectation of what the UN troops can do.
Particularly in cases where it becomes a civil war, right?
Exactly.
It becomes clear in the book, especially as you look at this period, that you took these failures personally.
Yes, I took it personally in the sense that often you saw the human suffering, you saw the traumas the people lived through, and wondered what it will take to move us as a human humanity to help in these dangerous situations. You cannot see the conditions on the ground and not feel it intensely. And as one of my predecessors said, our objective is not to take people to heaven, but to prevent humanity from going to hell. And it's a tough job. It's something you do every day. You have to wake up every day ready to start again.
So you're saying that governments have not done a good job of explaining to their citizens the risks or even the role of the UN as a peacekeeping institution?
There's part of that. And also we at the UN have to take some of the blame because we have not lowered expectations, creating the impression we are here to save people, even when we have very limited resources. And we have to be very clear with the population and the countries we enter what we can do and what we cannot do.
Let me turn to Syria. You served as a special envoy. You forged a proposal that was never carried out, and you left expressing great frustration with both the Syrian government, the opposition, and notably the international community.
I think we knew the Syrian situation was complex, and there were lots of divisions, particularly on the side of the opposition. We also knew that there were divisions in the region that we needed to try and bridge. But above all, I told the council members, it's a tough job. I'm going to try it. It can perhaps be done if you stand united and work with me in putting sustained pressure on the protagonists or the parties to come together and seek a political settlement. They all indicated they would. They supported the six-point plan, which was endorsed by a Security Council resolution. But it was more passive support than anything else. And then in Geneva...
Did that surprise you?
To some extent. But I kept working hard with them. They all signed on the 30th of June, and I expected them to come to New York and endorse it through a council resolution. They came to New York and started fighting on other issues, and they put up forward a resolution which the Russians and the Chinese vetoed, which I knew they would veto because they had told us in Geneva they wouldn't. And in the process, they dropped the ball on the substance. And yet, at the end of the day, they're going to need that political settlement and transition to resolve the issue. I don't see a situation where one side will win militarily, take over Syria, and there'll be peace and quiet, a clean victory.
But you expected them to come together. They clearly did not. You left and you used some rather undiplomatic language, I think, criticizing, finger-pointing, and name-calling in the Security Council. You felt angry?
I was disappointed. I was angry because people were dying. You know, these divisions in the international community, it was fine. The Syrians bear quite a lot of the blame, but we have enabled it by the divisions between us.
But this goes back to the larger argument of your book, the whole history of the peacekeeping. Does it suggest, the Washington Post columnist David Ignatius, he was citing the Syria situation and in context of your book, and he says it suggests the UN today is bootless.
When he said it's bootless, it can be both ways. Boots on the ground, which we don't have, if the member states don't give it to us.
Literally bootless.
And then the power, the question of do they have power to do this. But the UN power comes from concerted action of the governments. You will notice in the Syrian situation, it was fine when I was doing the work with the others, everybody hiding behind me and saying, we support so-and-so has done, and at the same time they were criticizing the UN and the envoy. Mm-hmm. When I stepped back, they had to confront the issues themselves directly, and suddenly I noticed a reporting change. Press asking, where are the member states? What are they doing? And suddenly you heard them talking about Russia, China, US and France. But until then, it was a special envoy who has not done this, or the UN, which has not done this.
Did you use the expression "hiding behind me"? Is that how it feels sometimes?
Sometimes it feels that. In fact,
that countries and others are hiding behind.
Yeah. We have a scapegoat role, if you wish, and an alibi role. When things are really desperate and hopeless, and you can't do anything about this, and there's a sense that something must be done. That's something usually leads to the UN. You dump it in the UN, and you, as a member state, you've done something. It's those incompetent people at the UN who are not delivering. You know, no. And my predecessor, Boutros, used to say, the letters SG does not stand for Secretary General, but scapegoat.
But it leads to the question, after all these years that you document in the book, and up to Syria, whether the whole notion of the international community and peacekeeping is basically a noble failure.
I wouldn't say it's a noble failure. We've had some success. It can be improved. I think the peacekeeping can do quite a lot if they are given the right mandate with the commensurate resources to get the job done. What is required is to ponder the questions I have raised, and for the member states to ask themselves what sort of reforms are needed.
All right, the new book is Interventions, A Life in War and Peace. Kofi Annan, thank you.
Thank you very much.